Before we start our terrific interview with Krystal Kelley, I'd like to show you something a little strange. First, notice this office, the studio, is completely different. It won't be different when we go to the interview, but we're going to see before that, Krystal and her team of social media experts working to build this studio into something much more fun and much more enjoyable for you to see, which is where I am now. For the next few weeks, we will be still in the old studio because the show is pre-recorded. But I just wanted to give you a taste of what it's going to be like and what Krystal Kelley and her team can do. And it is pretty amazing. So here goes. Here's a time lapse of the rebuilding of Whitney's Dreamland Studio.
This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we've got a new guest, a guest I have met. I have been on her show, and she's really cool. And her name is Krystal Kelley. Krystal is, well, we're going to, her motto is, I go where the day takes me, and the day took her by hook or crook to this show. And here we are. many adventures. I would say Krystal is an adventurer. She is a bridge builder. She started out wanting to become a reporter with National Geographic.
She has done all kinds of things. She has just been in the Bermuda Triangle. And in fact, she disappeared into the Bermuda Triangle, which is why she's here. So welcome to Dreamland, Krystal. Who knows where we're going to go today? We don't.
I agree. I don't know. Like you said, my motto is I go where the day takes me. And I feel like I've been in a bit of a dreamland this last month. I was at the southern tip of the Bermuda Triangle in Puerto Rico. And we were doing some investigations as a UFO hotspot that's there. The energy there, the feeling, the loss of time. I'm gonna say when we were recording, I was keeping track. I was logging our videos as day one, day two. I got to day 11 and I stopped keeping track of the days because I didn't know if it had been the next day, the previous day. I wasn't sure. And now I'm calling day 11 the infinite day because day 11 was like 20 days long.
I got an email at one bar text from Krystal at one point saying, I'm lost in the Bermuda Triangle. Now you're hearing why. This is so cool.
I know. It's, there's a lot of strange things happening there. And at one point we were doing a meditation in the water and I got a download that it's a strategic location on this planet. So I believe it's some sort of portal. I know there's, loads of history about the Bermuda Triangle of like things not working. Our GPS didn't work. Lots of times our cell signals wouldn't work. There were times when we went to this location, a very remote location called La Cartagena, and it's a lake, and it is it's in the middle of nowhere. We were driving through. Our GPS didn't work, but one of our crew had been there before, so she was pretty sure that we were going in the right direction. And we get out of the car, and out of nowhere, I'm not kidding, a park ranger just showed up and he's like, you can't be here. And we were like, well, we thought there were bathrooms. And he said, well, we're shutting down the park right now. And it was middle of the day. Like it was very strange. He made us get back in the car. He told us where we could go, which is where we went. And we arrived at this lake and we thought we would do a meditation. There's been a lot of stories of craft coming and going from this lake. And as we sat down to do the meditation, all of a sudden it was as if someone called in the bugs. We got bit, like there were no bugs before. And then all of a sudden we couldn't even concentrate on the meditation. We couldn't do the work we wanted to do there because we got bombarded by, and they weren't mosquitoes. They were like little tiny bugs. And we were all laughing like, oh, did they call in the drones? Like what is going on? After like further investigation, we found out that there is a military base in that, right where we were, where we weren't supposed to be, where they told us to go. It was adjacent to there. And there's something going on there. There was, I almost feel like GPS doesn't work because someone's blocking it. It's a strange feeling. The whole time when we were walking from where we parked to the lake, it was maybe a 20-minute walk. We all felt as if we were being watched, and we didn't see anything. But we could feel it. And even my 8-year-old daughter was with us and she was like, she was saying, I see something over there. And she wasn't imagining these things because we all felt it. And that was the first day.
So the first day.
Yeah.
Okay. So I gather let me exit the solo layout so I'm not a disembodied voice. So now this military presence interests me a lot. What lake was it? What was it called?
It's called La Cartagena. And and I'm going to tell you an interesting story. One of our producers sent this to me the day after we were there in the 80s. I believe it was the 80s. I might have the date wrong. But Puerto Rico had an earthquake. Now, this earthquake, the epicenter was at La Cartagena. And the people in the town surrounding there, they didn't think it was an earthquake. They thought there was some sort of explosion under the ground. And from the research and the feeling that I got there is that there is some sort of underground military base. You can't see anything from Google images, but there's something going on underneath that ground area. And there's restricted signs everywhere. You can't fly a drone there because we had all of our camera gear. We were thinking, oh, we'll fly a drone over the lake. We'll, you know, kind of figure out things. But it wasn't going to happen. We didn't see one person except that park ranger who appeared out of nowhere. Like, I really mean he appeared out of nowhere. Like we all got out of the car. We were, we didn't even hear a car pull up, nothing. And all of a sudden he was like, I turned around and he was like right in my face. And I was like, oh, and he said, I'm about to close the park down. You need to leave. And I was like, oh, we thought there were bathrooms here. There's no bathrooms here. Like just very, very matter of fact.
In the middle of the day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he was a U.S. park ranger or what kind of?
That's what. Yeah. And it says as you go in that it's a national park. Puerto Rico is a really interesting place because it is a U.S. territory and they use, you know, U.S. money, the U.S. dollar, but they very, very strongly speak Spanish. They try not to. There's even people in town when we were in Rincon doing our alien open mic that they were supposed to present. And when I went up to him and I was like, oh, are you presenting today? And he pretended like he didn't speak any English. And my producer is like, no, Ike speaks English. I've talked to him before. And I was like, oh, okay. But we did have a bell. He was our host and our guide. So, he spoke Spanish and kind of showed us the island. He lives there and is very in tuned, I would say, to the nature of the island. And yeah, I mean, La Cartagena is definitely a mysterious place and somewhere that is, I want to say they try to hide it. I'm interested when we do get our episode out and we spell out the history of the area. It's very interesting.
When you say your episode, I don't think you've really just told us exactly what you're doing.
So yes.
Give us an idea of what the episode is.
Yeah. So I'm working on a project called The Universe on Earth, and it's a collective of individuals that have come together. A lot of us have actually had dreams about this project independently of each other. And what we're doing is we're trying to connect with the locations that pull us. And usually the pull is it's created from people's stories of mystery. And we're not guaranteeing that we'll find out any answers. In fact, going to the Bermuda Triangle, I have more questions than answers from being there. But we want to just tell the stories of the mystery. And people can decide whatever they decide from that. We're just giving information. Right now we're doing North and South America. Our next location is actually at the base of Mount Rainier in Washington State. There's a 30-mile radius there that has a lot of unusual sightings. In 1947, it's where the pilot Kenneth Arnold spotted what he called flying saucers, and that's how they got the name flying saucers.
Right.
Was from Mount Rainier. And apparently, according to MUFON, Mount Rainier and Washington State in general has the most amount of UFO sightings in the country.
So what are you going to do there?
So what we do is we are hosting an alien open mic. And this is what we're doing at all the locations we're going to, is we host an event. We invite people to come tell their stories, to share, create a safe space, a healing space where it's released of any stigma, where we're just open to hear what people want to share. And then from that, we go to specific locations that we find out about and feel the energies there for ourselves and document that as we're doing it. And that usually includes meditations, sitting in the space. I get a lot of information from the water. So we try to submerge ourselves.
Get information from the water. I'm fascinated. What does that mean?
So water is a conductor. It can transmit energy, just like crystals can transmit energy and information. They store information. And so I don't know if it's a biological thing that happens, but when I go into the water, I instantly get, I call them downloads, but things pop into my mind that are not, I couldn't make them up. Maybe it's an act of imagination. I don't know, but when I was in Rincon and I went into the bay there for the first time, instantaneously it popped into my mind, this is a strategic location. That's not really something I would think. Those aren't even words I would use. I don't have like a military background, and strategery isn't quite my thing, you know. I go where the day takes me. These things happen, and then from that information, it usually leads to the next source of information. But the water holds it holds consciousness, it holds ideas. I'm sure you've heard of Dr. Emoto. He was a Japanese.
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
but tell us a little bit about him anyway. So, because I've heard of him, I'll bet some of our listeners haven't.
Yeah, he's passed now, and his family is still carrying on his work. But he was a Japanese doctor, a scientist, and he would say words to water, and the water, he would take pictures, and the water molecules react to the words that you say. And if you think about our bodies, we are over 80% water. So where are we storing our information in our bodies? I think it's fairly well known that we do store information in our bodies. And there's another woman that I want to mention. She's from Australia or New Zealand, and her name is Vita Austin. And she's kind of taken Dr. Emoto's work to the next level. And what she does is she has a method. She uses a petri dish, and she'll put the petri dish filled with water over an image, or she'll say a word to it, or a song, or something like that. And she freezes it. And when she takes it out of the water or out of the freezer, the water has an image in it. And it's fascinating to see that the water is so smart, so intelligent, like beyond what I think we really know. I'm convinced water holds consciousness. It holds energy, it holds information. And when we, as in our bodies, we're electromagnetic creatures, when we connect with our electromagnetism into a body of water, we absorb information from that location, that the Earth is also an electromagnetic being. So we're transferring information from the Earth into ourselves when we are in the water. That's how I believe it.
I think that we have to be open to it, or, you know, it doesn't happen. I always tell people who meditate with me, don't forget to bless your water.
Yes.
To bless your water, to thank. Before you drink water, thank mm-hmm. the earth and bless the water. I give this water my blessing, because it's telling the water and the earth that you care about this. Mm-hmm. You care. And, you know, we live this unbelievably heedless, headlong life, and we don't care. But if you do that, and you find yourself caring more and more, the more you try, the more you care. Mm-hmm. And the more you care, the more conscious you are. So tell us about your meditation process, because I have a feeling that this is, but before you do that, free Dreamlanders, we're going to tell you about some things that you're just going to love. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young, I believe that it was kind of blonde, and he was very tall, like at least six feet, and he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audiobooks, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful Revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical Mysterious Powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure.
learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today.
Okay, we are back with Krystal. Krystal just drank a little water on the break, and I asked her if she blessed her water. She said yes. And tell us a little bit more about your relationship with water.
Do you hear some audio?
Don't worry about it. This is Dreamland. Okay. It's full of ghosts.
Okay. I understand.
Right now it looks fine, and we probably have a good show. But yes, you will hear whispers and other voices. for the course.
I totally understand.
I know about the dead. They're talkative as hell. Go ahead.
It's very true. So my meditation process it's interesting, because a lot of times I'll go to a location and I know I'm going there. Sometimes the night before or a few nights before, I will get a dream or some sort of notion. Sometimes these things happen waking as well, not always asleep, but something will pop into my mind. And I'll give you a good example of this. I was in Egypt and I was with a group of 18 sound healers. And at the end of the trip, we were going to go into the Great Chamber, the King's Chamber in the Great Pyramid of Giza. We were going to go there before sunrise. And I was really excited about it. But the prior 9 days we spent on the Nile River, like sleeping on a boat on the Nile River. And the amount of downloads that I had on the Nile went from ancient times of Atlantis, Lemuria, all these things. But I had a really specific dream come to me. And we were in the Great Chamber, the King's Chamber. And in the dream, we were in a circle, and I led a meditation where we all had a star, our soul star, above our heads. And that soul star, all of us connected in a circle, and we put our stars into the middle of the circle. And there was like a trail of light that happened from each soul star into the middle. And when you saw it, I was looking down on us, like from above, and it made this fascinating pattern of the seed of life, if you know what that pattern looks like. And when all the soul stars reached the middle, they flew through the top of the pyramid and out to the stars above. And and it was so powerful. And I woke up from that dream, and I told the woman who was organizing the trip, I said, I had this dream, and I can tell you how to do this meditation. Can you guide us in this meditation at the end of the trip when we're in the King's Chamber? Because I just think it's really powerful. And she looked at me and she was like, Krystal, why don't you just guide the meditation? And I was like, oh yeah, then I don't have to teach you. That makes sense. So I did that, and we did the meditation. And it was afterwards, I was literally electrified. Like I felt so much energy in my body that I almost couldn't stop shaking and moving. It was, I had to ground myself afterwards outside. I had to take my shoes off. I had to sit on the ground. I had to have my feet on the ground because I thought I was going to fly away. But the meditations that I do are specific to the geography of where I'm at. And when we were in the Bermuda Triangle, we wanted to meditate at the beach one day, and it was a beach that had had lots of sightings. And so we thought, we'll call in the craft. We'll, you know, that was our goal. We'll call in the craft. And we get to the beach and it is like over 100 degrees. It's so hot. We can't even sit in the sand. So we go to the shade under the palm trees and we try to set up there. And it's like, there's bugs and insects and all. And we're like, ah, we can't do it. And at one point our camera guy is like, well, I guess we're not going to do the meditation. And I was like, no, we're going to sit in the water. So there were four of us and we went, four of us plus our camera guy, but, the four of us went into the water and we sat there and we did a meditation and the water told me what to say. It wasn't what I had prepared. It taught us to flow. It was quite amazing. This meditation that was just downloaded to me in real time. Like it wasn't a dream. It was real time. And after we were done, we all spontaneously started dancing in the water, which was just so joyous and so amazing. And then I asked everyone, did anything come to you in the meditation? And Alder, my co-producer, she said, well, something really interesting happened. And I was like, what was it? And she said, well, when you were taking us out beyond the planet, a being came to me, like was right there. And she said, but when I looked at the being, it was human. And she said, she asked it, are you from Earth? And he said, yes and no. And she said, you know, asked if he had a name. It was a male figure. And he said, Moksha. And when we got back, we looked up Moksha. And it's a Moksha is actually from Hinduism, a creature that represents enlightenment. Among other things, but he's a human, but also a spirit, which we all are. But it was just interesting that popped into her mind as we're going out beyond our planet, exploring in the astral way, that she meets someone who is of Earth and not of Earth, you know. So it was a really magical experience, and unexplainable. I don't think that those are things that you can fabricate in your mind when it's so pure and so beautiful. And we're just all exploring.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, Moksha came out of out of nowhere. And I'm not on the thing again. Just a second. I like to do the solo layout when the guest is really going, but then when I talk, I always forget, yeah. I'm on the solo layout and people get a disembodied voice. But that's okay. That's really fascinating that it would be Moksha.
Have you heard of Moksha?
Of course. I'm very involved in this whole, I am very involved in world religions, and I don't make any distinctions. In other words, I'm not a chooser. I'm an explorer.
Yep.
I'm as involved in Christianity as I am in Gnosticism, in Hinduism, in Buddhism, in various many different forms of Islam. I have a mala. Speaking of Hinduism, because it, the number 108 is so strange and so magical. There are 108. Do you have a mala too? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This is an unusual one. It's a Merkaba, and I hold the Merkaba above my heart. Like I wear it on my heart.
Yeah.
And because our personal Merkaba exists in our heart, and to wear the crystal of the Merkaba above my heart, I hope that it radiates and amplifies the feeling of love that I like to give.
Well, so we're both into this, and yeah, I But that's a very intense. And Mosheka came from because that's a real being, and these beings, and that's another thing we don't understand. In the West, we banished all the gods, except one who didn't want to be a god in the first place, Jesus. And then now we say there are none. We're living in a godless secular world, and this is insane. It's not sane, because not only are there not none, they're all still here. Mm-hmm. But they're not like beings sitting on a mountain somewhere. They're part of us and part of the universe in a very deep way. Mm-hmm. And the number 108, I've had an expert on malas and Hinduism on recently, or I will have shortly. I'm not sure when she's scheduled. The reason that number is important is if you take 108 and multiply it by the diameter of the Earth, you get the diameter of the Sun.
Oh.
If you multiply the diameter of the Sun by 108, you get the distance between the Earth and the Sun. If you multiply the diameter of the Moon by 108, you get the distance between the Earth and the Moon. Mm-hmm. Now, that tells me that whoever decided that number, 108, for this prayer thing, knew something about the world that they should not have known in those days. Mm-hmm. And it is a mnemonic device from a lost science, mm-hmm, that also included the science of the soul. Mm-hmm. And that is what we've lost somewhere before history even began. The soul part of science was stripped off of mankind. You're trying to get it back again.
And yeah. I love that. Yeah.
You're one of the seers. Yeah. But you think of yourself, she's a new age seer. No, she's not. She's a science seer. She sees an ancient science. That's what your relationship with water is all about.
Yeah. It's really funny because we were, we went to another location called Utuado, and it's the highest point of Puerto Rico. And it's, I was told by a local that, when Puerto Rico was invaded, it was where all the indigenous people went for respite to hide, it's very protective. There's protected energy there. And when we were there, we were at the very top of the mountain. We could see out into this valley, and we were sitting by the fire, and I made a comment that, like, I was just joking. And I was like, I love how scientific our experiments are, our investigations that we're doing here. And everyone kind of laughed because in a Western way of science, maybe it doesn't seem scientific what we're doing, but we're really connecting in a way that is very, very strong and pure. And we're sitting there, and there were fireflies flying around us, and all of a sudden, a bell was like, we should take some photos. And so we start taking photos, and we're just enjoying the evening. And and then my 8-year-old was sitting there, and she said, "Mom, do you want me to ask the?" She said, "Do you want me to ask them the questions?" And I was like, "Who's them?" And she said, "They're here." And I said, "Yes. Like, what do they want to tell us?" And she started channeling these beings that were among us, and she said, "Oh, you need to start taking pictures now, now, now." And that's not something my 8-year-old would say. And so we took pictures where she said to do it. And there were these lights and these things that we couldn't see with our eyes. We could feel presence of something, but we couldn't see it with our eyes. But the camera captured it, and we all posed. It was as if we had a photo booth with our galactic friends. Like it was just the coolest experience. And each one of us posed in front, and there's these pictures, and I'll share them with you, of these beings behind us. And then my daughter did one, and she did this like this, and it was like she was looking right at the being that was above her. And we asked her to ask them who they were, and they said that they were queens. And then she said, well, who are we? And she said that they named Nyla, myself, and her as princesses. And then we asked, well, are there kings? And she said, there are, but they are bad. And we were like, well, are the kings here too? And she said, they're not here because it's safe here. And it was just fascinating. My 8-year-old doesn't talk about kings and queens. And it was just a very connected experience. We did try to take some photos from other angles. We couldn't capture the same thing as where she had told us to take the pictures, where the backdrop was this vast expanse over the mountain. If we took a photo with like the trees behind us or something else, they weren't appearing. So it's as if they were just kind of dancing in the ethers out over that valley. It was a magical experience.
Well, we're going to take a little break and absorb the magic of that experience. But before we take the break, people are going to want to engage. I've been putting youonearth.com up and your YouTube channel, which is way cool. Tell us about like the Mount Rainier experience. How do people do that?
Yeah, so there's two ways that people can engage. They can sign up to present at our Alien Open Mic. We have limited space, but the sooner you sign up, the more likely we'll be able to fit everybody in. And people can talk about their experiences. Some people have seen crafts in the sky. Some people have engaged with beings. Whatever stories you want to share, it's an open mic. Like literally, we've had people play music like that they channeled from you know, experiences. And then the other way to engage is to attend. At that event, we're going to have a screening of the Maury Island incident, and it's a 30-minute short, and it's about the very first UFO sighting in modern history. It happened in 1947, 2 weeks before Roswell. There was a man who was fishing off of Maury Island, which is it's in Washington State, and Maury Island looks at Mount Rainier. So it's kind of like the same location, even though if you can't really, it's probably 100 miles apart, but they feel like the same there. And this fisherman was with two helpers, his dog and his son, and they were fishing, and they saw numerous craft hovering over their boat. And then one of the craft started having some sort of problem, and it burst into flames, and it put schlag all over the boat. There was like things coming down onto his boat. And in fact, his dog got killed from the aircraft or the craft, whatever it was. He described them as flying saucers. And then the next day was the first reported sighting of the Men in Black. And these men in black came to his home, and he didn't want to tell them the story of what happened because he was so scared. His son had been hit by the slag and had a wound from it, and he wouldn't tell the story. And so the men in black said, well, can we tell you what happened, and you can tell us if we're right or wrong? And they repeated the incident exactly as he remembered it. And he was so freaked out that he didn't want to he just didn't want any part of it. If you look up that story, the Maury Island incident, the first thing you'll probably find on the internet is that it was a hoax. But there,
yeah, I saw that the Wikipedia entry is so sick.
It is. And, you know, it's the history that's hidden from us that, and this is why we think it's so important and why we're doing a screening of the movie, is because this local historian, Steve Edmiston, he spent years combing through the FBI files, because the FBI actually came and did an investigation for J. Edgar Hoover, and reported back to him that this is not a hoax, but the news stories all say it's a hoax. He interviewed family members that remembered that the son had the scar of the incident. There's so much evidence that it was not a hoax. And again, this happened 2 weeks before Roswell. So if you look at, they call it the Summer of the Saucers in 1947, that summer were widespread sightings. Roswell happened. So many things. And the Maury Island incident, this historian traced it back to, it was the very first one that was ever reported that he could find. So it's important to know that our history is shrouded by
lies.
Yeah.
Lies.
Yeah.
It's really terrifying, but what's not terrifying, folks, is that you're going to not have a ordinary break this time, because I suspect that you tune out the commercials completely. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make an appeal to both subscribers and non-subscribers. We're losing subscribers, and we shouldn't be.
Ooh.
We should be gaining subscribers, folks, on unknowncountry.com, because it costs a lot of money to do this. And as you know, I am not exactly a rich man. So don't sit back. Go to unknowncountry.com and join our community. Two reasons. First is it's a beautiful community. And second is it is really valuable. Dreamland back to 2004, an immense resource in terms of wisdom, high strangeness, and just plain fun. All of the news stories, all of the other podcasts, the wonderful Ann Strieber Close Encounter podcast, and the William Henry, remember William Henry's podcast? All of this stuff is there. So go to unknowncountry.com and sign up today. And now let's get back to Krystal.
Well, okay. I agree. You shouldn't be losing subscribers, because these topics are really important. Uncovering history is, I call, humans fell from grace when at some point, a lot of the indigenous tribes of the world have stories of these magnificent star people, of all these things. And, we're now trying to peel back the layers of the truth. You know, we're very programmed from a young age to learn math even in a certain way. And math doesn't exist the way that we're taught. I believe there's some really amazing breakthroughs happening, a shift in consciousness that we're moving towards a collective. Because when beings evolve, we evolve on an individual level to become a part of a collective. And this shift in consciousness is, it's important. It's amazing when we're connected in that way of that consciousness. I have to say, even meeting you, Whitley, was a conscious, happenstance coincidence that, my friend Jeff told me to message you, and I did. And then you called me like a few minutes after I had sent the message, to the point where I was like, wait, how did he even know? You know, like it was, it was perfectly timed in the synchronicity of the way the world works. But in our modern world, oh, I can't hear you.
I'm sorry. That's entirely my fault, folks. But if you read lips, you will find out that I said the secret of the ages, but unfortunately I forgot it. No, what I was saying was that I called you immediately because there's a subtext that comes with certain texts, and that text had a subtext with it. That's why you're here.
Yeah.
Because clearly, when you talk about downloads and things, you're actually talking about something real in your life. I know that for certain, because I got one immediately upon receiving your text that told me to call her. This woman is useful to you.
Yep.
And that's the downloads I get are not sentimental, but they are practical in that when I thought, I don't know why, but I will do this. And I did it.
Yeah. And, you know, so one of the things that my missions that I focus on with our universe on Earth is so video production. As a young person, I went to school for broadcast journalism because I was very, very interested in the whole process of video production, of creating a story, of telling a story, and then that story being recorded for an infinite amount of time beyond my lifetime. Someone can hear this story. My children's children can see it. And so when I'm editing videos, I'm not just going through motions of editing the video. I'm infusing I'm infusing things into it. It's almost like a Reiki of some sort, interacting with the video content and what I'm doing. And it's light codes. It's things that words can't describe. It's feelings that you receive when you just experience things. And these, I hope my mission is that when someone watches it, they could watch it now, they could watch it in 10 years, in 100 years, they get that feeling that I was trying to evoke in that video. And so that's why I do what I do, because I'm hoping to ripple these feelings of love and compassion and connection with ourselves, like our inner selves, and then also that collective connection that we have that goes beyond time. Like time kind of doesn't exist in the universal world. That connection that we can have with someone, even as you do after someone passes, there's still communication going on.
Sure. Yeah, she's very much involved.
I know.
Oops. What am I doing? That lady back there, her.
Yeah.
I'm not going to try to point at her again because mirroring doesn't mean I'm not sure where my finger is going. But anyway, yeah, that's definitely a huge, huge part of my life right now.
Yeah. And it's very real. Like you said, that all of this is almost real. Beyond real.
That's exactly what we have done to ourselves. Is it's like we've taken hot pokers and just pushed them into our eyes and blinded ourselves as a culture in the West. It's not like that. I was in India, and you know, I went into India in January in as a Westerner, and I, you know, toured India. I meditated under the Bodhi tree and Bodh Gaya. I went to Varanasi and all of these wonderful things. But I just did it as a tourist. I wasn't in any way engaged. I come home, and I think I may have told you this story before, listeners. The goddess Kali came into my life, blasting, out of nowhere. And now I have a mala. I say mantras, and I'm engaged with this whole level of very rich, complex deities that are the deities of Hinduism, just as I am with Buddha, just as I am with Jesus, just as I am with the old gods of the West. And, you know, there's probably only one presence, but you can see it through so many different windows. And each window offers another level of energy to us. And each window, we call them gods, each window into the presence.
And we learn, I align with that very much. And I do believe also these windows open when we're ready, you know, when
right.
It's almost as if, like I was saying, peeling back layers. It's these things occur when we're ready. I think that life isn't really about learning. It's about remembering. And we remember who we are deeper and deeper, all the way to a cellular DNA level. You know, it drives me absolutely crazy to think that scientists say that we have junk DNA. There's no junk in us.
I agree with you there. I don't think there's any junk at all.
No, we have
a lot that we don't understand about ourselves.
Yes. Yeah, yes. Exactly. Every tool that we need exists within ourselves. Everything we need to heal exists on our planet. There is an herb or something that grows, or our earth is abundant. We don't need anything other than what we're provided by our mother. I mean, it's called Mother Earth for a reason, you know, and we have all these tools, but they've been hidden from us. They, you know, we have source of the sun. It's the sun is a life force. It's giving life on this planet. It's allowing the mother to grow the things that we need. It's allowing us to live.
And to assume that this is all passive and unconscious and dead is sort of weird. I think that we are conscious, and therefore our relationship with the star, the planet, and the world they have made is conscious. So, well, listen, what in terms of, you know, we've hardly done anything about getting into your past and your life journey, and there is such a life journey here. So what I want to do is to ask you a question. In your bio, it says you feel magnetic pulls to specific energy points on Earth to heal herself, her family, and Mother Earth. When did that start? When did all of this start? Because you're not leading a normal life. You're not leading a usual life. I mean, look at the room you're in. It's filled with unusual life. So tell us, when did this all start? There was a time where you were just an ordinary little kid running around kicking a ball, or not?
You know, I spent a lot of time as a child with my grandpa, and I remember he would tell me, Krystal, you're not normal. You're really special. And I thought, oh, he's so silly. He probably tells all his grandkids that, because he had like 20 some grandkids. But I would spend time, he lived on Lake Washington, and we would go out in the rowboat and we would fish for fish. And we would a lot of times not say anything. We would just sit there. And I learned more from just sitting there with him than I did from even the stories he would tell me. And then from a young age, much younger than most kids probably read about Buddhism, he told me, I think you should read this book called Siddhartha. And I was maybe in middle school, maybe late elementary, and I'm reading Siddhartha. And it just resonated with me. And then I had, I would say, kind of a falling from grace in the way that I was like, oh, I'm not special. I'm not these things. I'm just a normal person. And I, you know, went to high school, went to college, and things would always happen to me. And people would always say, you're so lucky. How do you do that? You're so lucky. And then I realized at one point, that I was feeling these pulls to do things. And then when I would do that, some luck would happen. And so I, as I've been going through my life, I thought, you know what, I'm going to follow these pulls because something good always happens. And these are not logical things. I remember at one point, I had my two daughters were young, like 6 and 8. And I have like 12 years apart from my two older daughters versus my 8-year-old now. So this is about 12 years ago. And I got an opportunity to work on a documentary project that was in Siberia. And it was a very remote location. And there were these indigenous people, these shaman, and they were going to ground Earth's energy. And I thought I was going to document them doing this. And so they traveled from all over the world. There were Koji Mamos from Colombia. There was a Navajo wisdom keeper. There was people from all over. Some people came from through Russia, which is the way I entered. And then other people came through China. And we all met in the Altai Mountains. And this is a location that is on the border of Russia, China, Kazakhstan, and Mongolia. So it's like a little spot on the planet. The indigenous people there call it the navel of the planet, not the center, but the navel. And I went there. I was the only one documenting. I had my cameras. I had everything, my audio gear. And I joined up with this group of people. And some really, really interesting things happened. First of all, my family thought I was insane. My parents were up in arms. How can you leave for a month? You have two young kids. But there was some sort of pull that I had to go. I couldn't describe it to people. Everyone's like, you're going to go to the middle of Siberia? Like, why would you do that? That's insane. But it was so strong that even with people telling me not to go, I had to do it. And I went there. And when I was there, because I was labeled on my permits and my visa as media. And I was the only one labeled as media because everyone else was a shaman or, all these things. And when we got to this very remote location to go to the Ukok Plateau, the Russian guards wouldn't let me cross over into Kazakhstan. And even though I had the permit, I had everything. So the whole group went across the border and I by myself was alone in Siberia, middle of nowhere. And I was like crushed. I was like, how can I document this amazing thing these people are doing? And I almost like cry when I think about this, but like, I thought this isn't supposed to happen. Like I'm supposed to document them. But what I didn't know is that I was supposed to get to know myself. It took me 3 weeks to get back to the United States. And there were spirit guides that told me to go to certain locations. And I would like, we didn't have cell phones back then. And I mean, we had cell phones, but our cell phones didn't work in Russia. So it was quite miraculous. There was a woman who was a psychic that was part of the group. And I never met her actually, but there was a house that we had stayed at and all at different times, because like I said, we were coming from all over the world. So the group kind of met up in different times. And so at this house, I knew I needed to get back to that house because it was the only safe place that I knew. And I thought if I can get back there, then I'll be able to use a computer. I'll be able to, figure out how to get home. And so, and a lot of my cameras were confiscated. They took like most of my gear. There was one that they thought was a cell phone, but I got to keep it because they didn't know it was a camera. And I got back to that house and I walked in, and sitting on the side table, there was this package and it said Krystal on it. And I was like, that's strange. And when I arrived, the woman that was there, her name was Ann. She didn't speak any English, but she had heard that I had gotten separated from the group. And when I got there, she started crying. She was giving me a hug. She was saying all these things that I didn't know what she was saying. And she brought me in and like kind of showed me this package, and she's like, here. And I open this package and there's a note in it from this woman, Jackie. And it said, Krystal, I know you haven't met me, but I had a premonition that you're going to need this. And so I went into town and I bought you a Russian cell phone, and she preloaded it with like an hour of time to talk or whatever. And that phone literally is how I ended up getting back, because if I hadn't had that, I don't know how. I'm sure things would have worked out, but she left it there for me week before. When I was there, I didn't see it the first time I was there. I don't know how I didn't come across something with my name on it, but when I needed it, it was there. And so, you know, the lessons I learned, the things that, that guided me, I call them luminous beings that were there in the mountains in Siberia, that I felt their presence. I think they've been guiding me my whole life. I now have conscious communication with them, and but it's like when I kind of woke up with that journey, and it wasn't at all what I expected. It was not what I expected, but it's what I needed to go on this path. And so, and that's why I say it's a path of remembering, because it's, you know, it's emotional too, you know, like it's a, yeah, I can't, I'm, okay. Can't believe that I don't always tell that story, and I guess I'm still healing from it.
Well, of course, it's a very intense, very moving story. And we're going to get into some more intense stuff, actually, after this, after our free Dreamlanders leave us. Krystal also worked for 7 years in conventional media until 9/11. And something happened then.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk about that. So free Dreamlanders, become subscribers, and you can listen to the rest of this too.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.